Good morning, everybody. This is Randy St. Clair, and I'm here this morning with the Air Taxi. That's this guy right here. Now, the Air Taxi is a scale model of a full-scale aircraft that doesn't exist. In other words, it's a fantasy scale. And by the way, what an Air Taxi is, the idea is that we'll have these aircraft that fly from micro-terminal to micro-terminal, and they work together with self-driving cars to provide a full end-to-end service, typically in an urban environment. So this is a potential design option, one of many. I should mention that there are many design options out there that people are considering right now. And I'm not stuck on just one of them. This is a demonstration of one possibility here. In fact, it seems to me the details of the design are what really matters in terms of the success or failure. In many cases, the individual design options, even though they look tremendously different, can be relatively equivalent in performance depending on the details. So let's take a look at this particular option and see some of the good and bad points about it. Now, to start off, it's obviously a tilt wing. And the other thing you may notice right away is that we've got all of these propellers. There's 12 of them, of course. Now, in this particular case, they're fixed pitch propellers, that is standard model airplane style propellers. But in the full-scale Air Taxi, they would all be variable pitch. And that's important because in hover mode, we've got all this combined disc area, which is actually considerably more than the wing area. And that allows for efficient or, if you will, a good figure of merit, to use a more technical term, for hovering in terms of being able to hover with low power. Not that these aircraft are designed to hover for any length of time, but still, it's an electric aircraft, everything needs to be efficient. And then in forward flight, as it transitions, then the wing, of course, would move, and various propellers would be feathered, that is, they would turn flat so they would produce minimum drag. And depending on what your exact flight mode is at any given time, you might have perhaps just two motors running, say in regular forward flight cruise mode. You might have four motors running in forward flight cruise climb. For rapid climb, you might have any number of propellers in any, it'd be basically your choice. But certainly in hover mode, you would have all of the propellers running because you want that disc area. Now, I should also point out that the Air Taxi is designed to have excellent control in all three axes. So, of course, we've got good control in roll because variable pitch propellers, a very fast dynamic response, and or you can speed up and slow down the motors is still also an option. In pitch, we've got sufficient lever arm here and plenty of area on both sides of the CG, so that's not a problem. And in yaw, well, yaw is actually kind of a combination of things. For the model, what we've got is a combination of what I call torque control. That is, these propellers with the silver spinners, they're turning counterclockwise. And then the ones with the black spinners are turning clockwise. And much like a standard quod, they can produce a yaw moment just by differential thrust. That wouldn't work terribly well for full scale. Although for full scale, remember, you do have variable pitch, so you can use that in differential. But I'm going to go ahead and turn on the transmitter here. Plug in my little voltage monitor so it doesn't complain. And then I'll go ahead and plug in the battery. Now, since we're in here, you may notice it's a little hard to see, but right here in front, we've got a data logger. We've got an EagleTree data logger, and you may have noticed the pitot tube up front. So we're measuring airspeed. We've got a GPS sensor in the back. We've got a barometric altimeter. So, by the way, this is not a proof of concept. It's too small a model to be a proof of concept. It's a demonstration of concept. So it's just basically to give people the idea of what's possible, because it's hard to see what's possible until it's right there in front of you. You can actually look at it and talk about it. So, but despite that fact, we do have it instrumented so we can get some fairly crude data on its flight performance, which I'll leave it at this, it's quite good. Without getting into technical details, we'll do that later. But it flies quite well. Now, coming back to the controls, let's see. So I mentioned hover control, or yaw control in hover. And by the way, that's what this switch is for. This is my, currently I have it set up on a three position switch. Now in full scale, you would have this, infinitely variable depending on the situation, of course. But for the purpose of a model, I have it set up so that there's three positions and a time transition between those. This would obviously be forward flight. Then this is what I call slow forward flight. And then finally, this is hover mode. Now, if you take a look at this, you may notice that the angle of the wing is still tilted fairly far forward. But in this configuration, it actually hovers stably. It's not trying to translate forward or backwards. And that's just because of the way the wing moves the airflow. Also, I think when it hovers, it's probably just a tiny bit tail down in this case. But that's a detail of implementation. So I was speaking of yaw control, and one of the methods of yaw control is ailerons. And we have fairly large ailerons. They move quite a distance. And these are effective both for models and for full scale, unlike, say, torque control, which is much more effective for a model. And then there's one more third provision for very good yaw control. And that is, if you look at it from the side, you may notice that these propellers are tilted slightly. Now, this has almost no effect on forward flight. But it does provide a little bit of a differential thrust. When these propellers are turning, it pulls it that way. When these propellers are turning, it pulls it that way. So all of these things combine to provide excellent yaw control, which is a problem for full-scale aircraft or many VTOLs of different types. And so let me lead from that into some of the design features to help provide adequate yaw control on a full scale. You'll notice it has these twin vertical stabilizers, and they provide, I would say, adequate directional stability in forward flight, but we want to avoid having excessive weather vane stability in a hover because that eats up your yaw control power. So that's why we have two of them. That way, in a hover, if you're in a crosswind, one of them partially blanks the other. It also has the convenient, helpful feature that they're smaller and lower. By the way, there's actually more vertical stabilizer area there than you might imagine because there's a subfin, which makes the plane look rather boxy from the side, but it actually increases the vertical stabilizer area in a place where you really need it, down low. It also provides a nice convenient place to attach the horizontal stabilizer right here, which is a full flying type. Now that's important because with an aircraft of this type, when you're in the transition phase or slow forward flight, we've got a general downwash field that develops around the aircraft, not just in the area of the propellers, but a much larger area. And this allows us to match the horizontal stabilizer to that downwash field, so it's not producing a pitch-up tendency of the aircraft. And as a matter of fact, the aircraft is in complete trim throughout the entire transition. And stable throughout the entire transition. Now, of course, it helps that it has a flight controller with auto level and all of that. That makes it even more stable. But the point being, it's efficient. Let's talk about ergonomics for a minute. Now, I'm talking about passenger ergonomics, not for the model, but for the full-scale aircraft. So if you were a passenger, you'd have to imagine you're about that tall. And the model doesn't perfectly reflect this due to some structural issues with the way it's made, but we want to make sure that we have plenty of room, head clearance, for the passengers to walk in and board the aircraft. Now, you'll notice that it has these side doors sort of decorated onto the side, and it's a four-door, just like a car. They open just like a car. It's a very car-like experience. So the passengers will be immediately comfortable with it. They know what to do. They know how to get in. They know how to get out. The step-up height is not terribly high, no worse than a typical SUV. Although even so, it might be advantageous to have a little pop-out step just to help small people and children get in. But it's still a very standard experience. And presumably the interior would be a standard car-like experience as well, seat belts and so on. Now you'll notice that the wing sort of blocks the path between the front and back doors. And the idea is that it's important to not have anything down there that's sharp that they can bump into, but a vertical wall like this, and by the way, when they're boarding, I guess I can't do this when the power's on, but this wing would be totally vertical in that case. And so when they're boarding, they would have to go either to the front or the back, or if for whatever reason they had to go around, then they would have to walk around the wingtip to get to the other side, but it's not a terribly long walk. So the main point being that it's easy to board and quick to board and comfortable for the passengers. So now let's talk about the landing gear for a minute, which is also important for these things. You'll notice it has a nice wide landing gear in the back, and it has this little suggestion of wheel pants. So this is a fixed gear. They're not retractable. If we don't need that extra complexity for an aircraft of this type. But it has a nice wide stance, and then it also has these twin nose wheels. And the fact that there's two of them is maybe an option, but the idea is that they're wide enough to provide additional stability. And these are, in the full scale, are assumed to be castoring, which is why they have this cute little fin on the back, so that they would remain aligned with the airflow in flight. But there's actually more to it than that, because these wheels in the back would be driven. They would have motors in the wheel hubs, and they would probably have an electric parking brake as well, because this is a fully autonomous aircraft. It needs to be able to drive to the location where the passengers will board. It needs to possibly be able to drive with the passengers inside. Now, not very fast. We're talking 5 miles an hour or so. It's certainly never, ever intended to drive on the road. It's not a flying car. It's an air taxi, and it's intended for that specific purpose. But it does need to be able to park itself, and it needs to be fully autonomous. So now let's talk about the battery. Now in the model, of course, the battery is right here in the nose. And this is really unrelated for the most part to what it would be like for a full scale. So let's talk about the full scale battery. Now I've indicated on the bottom here, let me just move the wing up so we can see it better. I've outlined this belly pan area right here. So we have this large, flat, somewhat thin area on the bottom of the fuselage, which would contain the battery. And this battery is removable for recharging, and I think that's really important for an aircraft of this type. We can't be charging these batteries in the aircraft. They would simply get too hot, and we would be trying to rapidly charge them all the time. These batteries need to be in the air as much as possible. They can't be on the ground charging. So the idea here is this belly pan battery is removable. You would have some sort of a robotic battery maintenance robot that would run under the aircraft to have a little scissors lift, drop the battery down. Another one would put the new battery in. Then you would take these batteries to a charging station where they can charge at a somewhat more reasonable rate. Where they're thermally controlled, they have fans to blow air over them or whatever is necessary to keep them from getting overly hot while you're charging them. And the net result is the batteries will last much, much longer, and it'll also improve the safety of the entire system because, the batteries are just in better shape, and you don't need to be tempted so much to be flying with batteries that have just enough power, even if just enough in this case means enough to complete the mission plus the required safety margin. You just don't need to push it that hard. And ultimately, it'll just save a lot of money, not to mention making a better system. So let's go over the radio systems for the model, and which actually, now that I think about it, there is some application to the full scale. You notice all the electronic speed controllers, or their equivalent for full scale, would be located here in the wing on the lower surface of the wing for easy maintenance and also for good cooling. You know, we might as well put them down there. They need to be out there anyway. And we want this whole system to be as low drag as possible. One of the things I want you to see from the camera's perspective is I want you to see the frontal view of this thing. Hopefully you get a good clean shot. And my point is that it's a relatively low frontal area. I mean, the whole thing is very clean. You're not seeing a lot of struts or, you know, things hanging out. Now, you see all these propellers, of course, but remember, in full scale, those would be feathered or driving, of course, in forward flight. So it's actually a very clean, low-drag layout, and that was one of the main goals of the design. It needs to be efficient in all flight modes. And in order to do that, it needs to have a good L over D. And in order to do that, it needs to be low drag. So there's a lot of attention paid to reducing the drag of the various external items. Putting these motors up on struts like this not only has advantages for hover, but it also makes them low drag. The high velocity airflow from the rotors is not scrubbing over the wing. Now, we do have, of course, these four rotors where it is scrubbing over the wing, and that's a small penalty, but it's a price we have to pay in order to get that high velocity airflow over the ailerons, so that when we're in hover mode, we've got that good yaw control that we really need. All right, so moving back to the configuration, for model purposes, these are just standard brushless motors. We've got the ESCs right here on the bottom of the wing. Now, you may be able to see here that there's bus bars running along the leading edge of the wing. There's two of them, and they're not even insulated. They're just copper, I believe, 14-gauge wire. And they run to the center here, where we've got this highly flexible wire that runs basically to the battery. So it's a very clean layout, very low drag. Everything's in the wing. You can see where the power and ground are coming off the bus bars to each of these ESCs, and there's 12 of them, so that's kind of a lot to manage. But you'll notice all the wires are nice and very cleanly done, and in full scale it would be even more so. Everything would be fully fared and internal and smooth. But even on the model here, we've got a reasonable airfoil surface, and it's all nice and clean. Now, once we get into the center of the wing here, we've got, well, obviously we've got this satellite receiver. That's just for model purposes, of course, because we want to have a good solid radio link. But you'll notice that these wires come down from the bus bars and they go right past the spar. And that's because, and I'll pull this off so you can see a little better, as the wing bends, we want to make sure that those wires have a nice open bend radius. And likewise, the control wires that control the speed controllers, the aileron servos, and so on, they all have a similar routing, and they all have a nice open bend radius so nothing gets broken. The other features of the radio are, of course, we have the KK2 board here running the OpenAero VTOL firmware, without which this design really wouldn't be possible. And it's actually been very helpful in many different VTOL designs over the last few years. I can't say enough good things about it. We also have a battery here. This is a 2.25 amp hour, 3-cell, so roughly 11.1 volts here. And you can't really see it very well, but right back there is the receiver. And then, of course, we mentioned the satellite receiver up here. And this little pile of wire and stuff is a battery eliminator circuit, a little switching regulator, because we want to have a separate power supply for powering the servos, mainly and especially the main tilt servo. We do not want to disturb the power supply, which has its own separate BEC, which is actually this little tiny black thing, which provides power to the flight controller and the receiver. So they have their own separate clean power, and that's important. Now, we also have in the model, I mentioned earlier, but I'll elaborate a little more, we have the Eagle Tree data logger system. So this is the main data logger here, and then it has these satellite modules. This one right here in front has some tubes attaching to the pitot tube here. That's for measuring airspeed. Then right behind it, you can't hardly even see it, this little module where my fingertip is the altimeter. And then also you really can't see it because it's way in the back here underneath the tail, is the GPS satellite receiver. And that's the VTOL Air Taxi. For more information and to see it fly, see the links in the box.